Good evening. Tonight, we're very fortunate to have the founder of Socio. Let's welcome Saket Duchima.
Good evening, everybody. About me, I run a startup called Socio, primarily a data platform for nonprofits, wherein we help them monitor their donors' data, do a bit of predictive analysis on that, and communicate the values of the work they have been doing to the stakeholders. And I'm primarily going now to talk about scalable machine learning with the project part. So we'll get started with a basic logistic regression with Theano, and we'll do the same what we are doing this part in Theano, this part, and we'll have machine learning logistic regression this part, and I'll talk about a couple of thoughts that I have on how a machine learning model should be designed and deployed in production, and in case if you have any supplementary thoughts or complementary thoughts, happy to hear that. So typically, how does a machine learning model? A machine learning model is basically a black box that takes in an input and throws an output. Take an image, tell you whether it's dog or cat. In this case, take a number, and this is the most famous MNIST data set, where you take digits and probably tell what the take characters and take images and basically tell what the digit is. The basic mathematics of any machine learning model is basically the output can be expressed as linear combination of the weights and the input variables. X1, X2, X3 are basically the variables, and W is basically the weight matrix, and Y is basically a linear combination of weight, W matrix, and X, the input parameters. And we pass it through an activation function. The activation function can be a sigmoid, can be a tangential tangent function, depending upon whatever you would want to use it. There is a library in Python, which is of course most popular by the folks in the University of Montreal. It's called Theano. And Theano helps us do several of these matrix multiplication calculations, which are required in machine learning or deep learning for that matter, over CPUs as well as on GPUs, because computations on GPU are much, much faster than 5 to 50x faster than what they are on CPU. Theano takes a very simple approach on dealing with variables. It has two things. The first one, which is it has symbolic variables, which essentially means you don't need to specify the value to a variable even at the time of execution. So let's say we have a variable x and y, and when you're calling the function, while you're calling the function, you can actually give it the value. The other good stuff about Theano is it has the concept of shared variable. Shared variable is essentially like, in case if there are two functions, they both can use the same value, and the value are going to be updated. So suppose there is a function which does a subtraction and there is a function which does addition. In case the value of x is say 5 and we reduce 1 to it, the value becomes 4. Upon this value, the addition will be done. The value upon which addition would be done is 4 and not 5. So essentially, functions kind of share the value. This comes important wherein there are multiple training processes going on in case you're running your gradient descent. So the matrix values get updated, and the value, there is no conflict of values in iterations. Let's see a demo of what I'm talking about. So basic import, by convention we refer matrices or tensors basically in capital. You can define a scalar variable, and you can define another variable which is squared. As mentioned, symbolic function definition, Theano.function, you define it over here, wherein the function x is basically the scalar, and y is the function definition over here. Now if I pass f2 to it, I get the square, if I pass 3 to it, I get 9. You can also call the function using dictionary type, which is pretty straightforward. you can have matrices, vectors, and in case you want to calculate a dot product, you do just T dot dot M dot V, and you pass it a NumPy array, and you calculate a product. In terms of shared variables, as mentioned, they are shared across all the functions, and let's define a shared NumPy array, and the D type as of now is used to specify the integer type, the 32-bit calculation or 64-bit calculation. As of now, the version of Theano allows you to do only 32-bit calculation. 64-bit is kind of coming. So for the purpose of generating, doing the logistic regression, I have kind of generated sample random data and plotting it over an XY plane. It's a sample 2D scatter plot. Logistic regression again, as we had seen, it's basically activation function and parameters and weights multiplied together, the dot product taken of the matrices, and in case if there is any extra variable, bias variable, we put that over there. So, do you want me to? I assume I should not be explaining or going through the details of logistic regression as such, rather than just giving you an overview and then probably going explaining the conceptual part. This just to show you how a basic logistic regression is done without any library draw logistic regression. Over here, we initialize a logistic regression with a two-dimensional input, shared X, which I have defined earlier, and we generate random sets of data to initialize it. And basically, when we have our activation function, we would want to minimize over a period of time the weight, and which would essentially give us optimized value, which would help us predict the value of the output and train our model. For that purpose, we use any version of stochastic gradient descent. In this case, I'm kind of currently using mini batch stochastic gradient descent called MVT. And let me show this. Essentially, what that does, it kind of helps you minimize your cost over a period of time and arrive at So currently I'm going on 500 iterations. Let me run this again so you can see to visualize. So this is the plotting of the cost function over a period of time. This is the 140th iteration. As it goes, it converges towards a value which basically is the minimum cost variable cost function. And once you have a logistic regression class, you, as mentioned, a logistic regression is seeing a combination of your weights and matrices. This is called a single layer perceptron. Single layer, as in there is one input, there is a hidden box, and then there is an output. In case if we have multiple layers of these logistic regressions, it kind of becomes multi-layer perceptron or neural network, or and which essentially leads to deep learning. So deep learning is nothing but multiple layers of logistic regression model attached towards a function. Let's go back to the presentation. So this is basic stuff so that you kind of know what I'm going to talk about. As mentioned, GPU computation takes much, much lesser time than what CPU computation does. In this case, CPU takes around 3 seconds and GPU takes around 0.6 seconds. It can go to much faster depending upon what is the kind of calculation that you are doing and what is the amount of data that you are processing. Okay, let's talk about parts. The cost of 1 terabyte of data is around $35. And then storage has become so cheap, people are storing tons of data and they want to process that data. daily logs at Facebook is around 60 terabytes, and the whole data stuff is, you have ample of hardware which can take in huge amount of data, but how do you process that amount of data? You need memory. Typically, you had MapReduce introduced for that particular purpose. So what MapReduce does, it's a cluster computing. I mean, you have data on your spread across, distributed across clusters. And you do a map job first on a cluster, take the data, do a reduce on another cluster, take the data, and keep on doing it across each of them. What happens is this read and write makes the whole process much, much slower. This led to another thought at Berkeley, and 2010 there was a Spark paper, and potentially it became a production grade software about 2014. What Spark does is it optimizes those calculations and does it in memory. So in case if you have, say, multiple reads and writes that you're doing, so it does, instead of going to just read and write, it does it in memory, which essentially makes the calculation much, much faster, or the operations much, much faster. Spark runs on top of, it can run on top of Hadoop, Cassandra, HBase, any of those file systems. And so the base layer over here is Apache Spark, which runs on any of these platforms. It has a couple of niceties attached with it. Spark SQL is almost like an SQL interface, which can help you write SQL queries on top of this data set. Spark streaming basically takes an ingestion point. It can either be your Amazon Kinesis, or it can be your Kafka, Apache Kafka. From there, it can ingest data, and you can do a distributed calculation on top of all those stream data. Maybe in case if you want to process tweets, generate sentiment of those tweets, you can have your Amazon Kinesis ingesting data from the Twitter stream, and that giving passing it on to the Apache Spark. Apache Spark kind of processes, distributes it across different clusters, and then you kind of process that data. MLLib is the state-of-art machine learning library that comes with Apache Spark. It has almost all the clustering algorithms, pipeline, which I'm going to talk about. And GraphX is basically the graph implementation of parallel distributed graph data structure on top of the Apache Spark in memory database. As mentioned, I published on their blog October 2014, about a year ago. Spark is about process around 1,000 terabytes of data in just record time of 234 minutes, wherein Hadoop process 102 terabytes of data, which makes it order of 10x faster, 100x faster. Spark operates via resilient data structures, RDDs. So RDDs are basically data stores which are immutable, and they are distributed across clusters. So this is a Spark driver, and then this is a typical, how a typical Spark cluster would look like. There is Hadoop HDFS data system, and these are clusters that you have decided for yourself, and it basically Spark takes data from here. It initializes a variable called SC Spark context, and once you have done that, you can run map job, you can run reduce jobs, you can do count, and several other things that you wouldn't do with the traditional MapReduce stuff. Let me show you a simple demo with Spark. So let's say I kind of define a simple word list.
Can you make it a bit bigger, sir?
Huh?
Can you make it a bit bigger?
Yeah, sure. Is it good? Is it good?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's define a simple, and I forgot to mention, Spark has interfaces with Scala, Python, Java. Scala and Python are interactive, but Java obviously is not interactive. So we are dealing with PySpark right now, the Python interface for Spark. Let's define a list, a usual Python list. And we parallelize this data across different clusters. And we do print, it prints a PySpark RDD structure. Now let's write a lambda function which would make each of these words plural and map it to the RDD that we have defined in the previous case. Simple again, x plus s, it takes an input variable and then add an S to it, and then you collect it. So cats, elephants, rats, dogs. Now let's collect how many rats we have, how many cats we have, and how many elephants we have. So what you do is, for each of the string that you found, create a tuple with key value pair, the occurrence. Now you group by key, and then you add those values that you had in the tuple space of the key, and then you collect them. And here you have your, there was two rats, two cats, one dog, and one elephant. So essentially what is happening over here is, in the older system at Ciano, which we saw, Ciano was dealing with GPUs. GPUs can help you do matrix multiplication much, much faster, of the order of 5 to 50 times. Spark, again, is an in-memory database, runs on top of CPU, so there is a trade-off between the GPU calculation versus the CPU calculation. And about a month ago, this was, again, a hybrid interface between GPU-CPU calculation, wherein you take the data from CPUs. For doing the calculation, you offload it to the GPUs, and once the calculations are done, you get the data back from the GPUs. So this was kind of done by Adobe Research, wherein they define a GPU thread, and the first is you prepare your data to take it away from, oh, okay. You prepare to read the data from the CPU, you initialize your CUDA drivers and do the calculation and return the value. So this is a hybrid GPU-CPU interface calculation, which probably, in case if you have to do tons of calculation, you can try it for yourself. Let's see at the same logistic regression part which we did with Ciano earlier, how that done in Spark. As simple, let's talk, see the data first. We have a string and it has one as in, so logistic, okay. Is it visible?
Yeah.
Cool. So logistic regression is basically a probabilistic method of probabilistic linear regression. Essentially, if the output is true, it's 1, if the output is not false, it's 0. So we have a string in case if Spark is present. Let's assume, you know, it's true, and in case if Spark is not present, it's false. If Spark is present, it's true. If Spark is not present, it's false. With a typical machine learning workflow, what would happen is, if you are not doing with Spark, or so you would typically be getting word to vec or NLTK in Python if you are using tokenize it, then tokenize the text to create words out of the text, and create run the hash function to generate the vectors from them. Over here, what Spark ML pipeline offers you, they can help you transform your data with the tokenizer function, which you can see over here. It converts your text into words. So input column is the text which we define over here. This is essentially a Spark data frame, the data frame which we talked about. Spark has a data frame of ML, so we are just kind of combining together the Spark SQL and ML together. So the data frame, we initialize the data over here, and we convert this data into tokens, wherein we extract words out of this particular text. It's going to add another column called words to this particular data frame, and after that, we kind of hash and run over a hashing function and get across the features. And at the end of this, there would be another column added, which would be called features. And then we call our, so these two are called transformers. Transformers are basically that kind of, you manipulate data and generate, manipulate the data frames and create another data frame. Estimator is basically a function that kind of runs on top of transformer. We are just defining our logistic regression over here with 10 iterations. And the pipeline kind of takes the tokenizer, the hashing function, and the linear regression. And we fit the pipeline, and now that's all we need to do to create a logistic regression for this particular data set. To test it, we generate the way we randomly generate the training data set, we generate the test data set over here, and let's predict the stuff. So it's running your logistic regression, and hopefully it also should be something. So spark in the text and hence the prediction is 1. There is no spark in text and hence the prediction is 0. There is spark in the text and hence the prediction is 1, and so on and so forth. So this is a very basic spark introduction. Now let's talk about the ML day-to-day things, how you know you kind of do your machine learning. Generally the concept or the notion is you have your data. You ingest the data in your classifier, you train it, and then predict it. I mean, but things are not as simple as this. The actual pipeline looks something of this sort, wherein it is broadly divided into three different categories, wherein the first is the data part. With the data part, you have to ingest your data, you need to clean data, you need to store it somewhere. For storing data, you can probably use.
Okay, could you folks read this slide?
Yes. So typical, you store a data, if you use Spark, you can distribute it across clusters, and then you do data munching and data cleaning, and you extract your features from system instantaneous reduction, CPA. And then you model your data. You can probably use logistic regression or whichever algorithm that you want to use. Then you train your hyperparameter, you tune your hyperparameters. You deploy it, you test it, and you validate it across the data set, and then you essentially deploy it. Deployment is generally, in case Python, you kind of take a pickle dump, and you put that pickle dump onto API server, which is usually the case of Spark server. And when you have your model in production, you're not done yet. I mean, you have to evaluate your model on the new data that keeps coming, Suppose you design the service for recognizing images as cats, and you train it on your historical database. Now when it goes into production, there is new data that the users are kind of using to get out from it. So what happens is you need to test the accuracy of the prediction of your service running in production as well, and keep evaluating your data set, keep evaluating your the models, and going back and forth, iterating upon your hyperparameters and tuning it. You have to monitor everything. Probably there might be some attack on your server. You have to keep logging all the requests. You need to take care of all those production related things that need to be addressed. And in case if you want, you would want to have report dashboard wherein you can keep track of reports, charts, number of requests coming from an IP address, number of requests coming from a geolocation, and see beautiful graphic of it. So this is how an actual machine learning pipeline kind of looks like. Let me describe it to you a bit more in detail. So you had your historical data. Historical data, typical cases of data set, say MNIST data set. Now what you do is, MNIST is pretty much organized, so you don't have to do anything. You kind of divide them or shuffle them into train data, test data, and validate data. Train, test, and validation data. And then you prototype your model. The way kind of we did just now was having data in the Spark shell, we kind of defined our data, in a very small part. And then we ran a logistic regression model with two different types of parameters, the number of iterations and the like param. And over a period of time, we need to keep on updating that, those hyperparameters, keep on tuning those hyperparameters so that depending upon whatever the request comes, we kind of give an actual sort of output. And for doing that, we kind of keep on versioning our model, API class V1, API class V2, API class V3. Typically what happens, if in case you are using scikit-learn or whatever, Theano, even Theano, you kind of take, in case of Theano, you kind of compile your function and compile your model that you have done, and then you pickle that, you dump that pickle, and then on your API server, which is basically Python server running behind the scenes for doing on. You load that function, a request comes in. So this is the request line, client makes a request, and then you queue that particular request because a good architecture would essentially not be covering responses directly, rather taking all the requests and queues. And in case if you want to have a couple of queues, I mean, a given customer should not make more than 200, you know, API calls a day. A given customer should not make more than 1,000 customers. A given IP address should not make more than 10 API requests a second. In case if it's making more than 10 requests, it's potentially fraud. So you have your API rules defined, and then once the request passes through the API rules, it kind of goes into your prediction service. Prediction service, again, is a Python server, Tornado, Flask, or whatever. It reads a data from, usually a data from a file server. File server can be your S3, or in case you are using a Azure, or something else, or it can even just be saved on Google Drive, right, and you should have access to it. So prediction server reads, dumps, and loads it into the loads in the request response cycle, and processes the input and gives the output to the client. Additionally, what it does is it kind of sends logs extra stuff into the prediction log database, and then this prediction log database kind of helps you add to the historical data that you would want to use. Additionally, this prediction log can be seen if you want to have an API dashboard, you see it inside your API dashboard. API dashboard should potentially have features like you should be able to design the API rules from your API dashboard, and maybe even geolocation should not have more than 10,000 requests per hour or stuff like that.
Yeah. Which APIs do people commonly use?
So people don't use any API. So this is in case we want to deploy your machine learning model to production. This is how we would go about designing your own API service, your own prediction service.
Okay, so for dashboard, I mean, do people not use third-party?
So dashboard is basically reading data. Dashboard is basically reading data from your prediction log. You can, in case you don't want to design anything, you can just have a Pentaho or anything of that sort of, you know, data reading tools. But in case you want to have additional features and functionalities, like, you know, you want to design your API rules just from this particular dashboard, in that case, you need custom implementation of any very simple web application that kind of has permission to edit things all over this particular page. So this is what the talk was about. My friend Manvik over here, he is the author of a deep learning library called OpenDeep, and he is building service which helps you do this entire stuff on top of Theano. It's called VitruvianScience.com. I have helped him with this architecture stuff. So in case if you want the early beta, you can go and sign up on VitruvianScience.com for early beta access. Yes. So that's most of what. In case if you have any questions, happy to answer.
So how nice could just play with that SKLearn? Is it ever going to be?
Basic stuff with Theano is, in case you are doing multiple or a large volume of matrix calculations, it helps you do it on GPU, where in SKLearn you don't have that particular functionality. You can import Theano and have your NumPy, ingest your NumPy arrays into Theano shared variables, and do those calculations on GPUs, get the value, and then have your model to predict the stuff.
But if the SKLearn guys were ever willing to course like the subset, I mean, you know, can these two ever be?
SKLearn ones, as I know, SKLearn ones on NumPy array, and Theano are compatible, so technically it should work. Yes. The thing is, I did not like in the typically in the MLlib library. Logistic regression is basically you have STD, you know, stochastic gradient distance, two, or the derivative of whatever you have of STD, maybe by STD momentum, or whichever you are using. It does not allow you to do it synchronously, it's not parallelized, so you cannot implement downpour like stochastic gradient distance using MLlib. It does it sequentially, it does not do it parallelly, so it kind of reduces the speed the calculation pattern sequence again, or so you can distribute the whole calculation, the whole data parallelism essentially is something which is difficult to obtain for your training or simulation. That is something like there might be potentially working for.
You are feeling that the prediction logging through historical data.
Yes.
Right. Your historical data will be contaminated in some sense because you are not feeding the actuals, but you are feeding the prediction.
It assumes that historical data and the data that is going from here is kind of the similar format. Otherwise, obviously, there will be conflict. But over here, it's assumed you are kind of sending us. So it's the data that is being sent from the prediction log database server on the historical data server, the kind of data set match. Essentially, they have to match.
Okay.
Yeah. So you won't be sending the meta variables, so which client ID or IP address from the user is coming, or what was the browser that the user was using. So all those metadata might not be sent across to the historical data. That might be use a partition can be created in the prediction logs itself, which can separate the metadata in a different table and the data that resembles the historical data into a different table. And that table, the table which has resemblance with the historical data structure can be kind of being pushed across to the data store.
That's one thing. But other thing is actually the predictions and what actually happens is the difference, right? Like suppose you're predicting stock market, right? Let's say.
Yeah.
The actual stock market price is over here.
Yeah.
So when you feed to historical data, you should not feed prediction logs under certain conditions. You should only feed the actual
request variable. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Any more questions?
Unless you say in the clean data you will take care of this.
Yes.
The discrepancy between prediction and the actual.
Yes.
You possibly will take care in the clean data.
Yes.
What size, like what maximum size data set you can get on a GPU these days?
G2 large, how long is public career?
Well, for G2 and AWS, is, I think
it is 8 gigs of memory. So in memory, 8 gigs. Yeah.
And is that like just integer or float?
How many?
Integer or float?
Float.
Sure. So, like, say, how do you?
Float 32.
How do you handle categoricals? Do you handle them compactly? Do you create dummy variables? Do you get memory bloat on any data set?
In which case, in case of Spark or in case of TM?
Well, okay, both.
So they both Spark again, as I mentioned in one of the interfaces. Over here, so you interface GPU and CPU using the CUDA driver, and CUDA driver kind of takes that way.
Okay, now I'm trying to ask, do you get any memory flow? If you look at categorical 32 levels, does that expand?
So again, the Spark, the way it operates is Spark process is essentially a JVM process, kind of. And RDDs are receiving data structures, which essentially means in case if one particular cluster kind of dies down, it is able to build again the data sets from the lineage tree that has been between two different clusters in case of parts and IDs. So in case of there is a failover or a memory bloat or something, it will be able to kind of build across the data set was essentially over there.
Yeah, but I'm only asking about in terms of memory, see if one categorical is 32 levels, does it get expanded to 32 bit variables or compacted? So like the H2O guys did an enhancement on JVM storage to get that compacted.
I don't know, I'm not aware of it.
Okay.
Would in case of your thing, if you have any thoughts of how you went about implementing your own production, say, of ML, I would be happy to hear who that is. And yes, who like of doing that.
Your slides will be available online?
Yes, I post them on Meetup.
From where?
On Meetup, coming, the event coming page.
Okay, let's make some. Does anyone in the audience have any announcements for the group? Yep, go ahead.
Hi, so in case you haven't heard, ATN Data Science Camp is free Saturday, October the 24th. And everybody's welcome, and we're all listening to all. So it's going to be a wide range of data science stuff, retail, natural language processing, cats and dogs, pictures. We welcome, you know, deep learning is the big thing this year, so.
Where is it?
PayPal, San Jose. Yeah, so just Google for 2015 SFA ATN Data Science Camp, or a COVID link. No, Saturday, October the 24th. You're confusing with COVID camp, which is 2 weeks before, in Evergreen. So go to there, just go to ours. Go to both. I'll post a link in the basic group, and might be able to get a coupon code. There's like a nominal $3 charge, bring a buddy charge, this, you know, this curves notion of, I won't get you guys any free link.
Anyone else? Okay, well, thank you for coming.